Which reminds me, I think that the four of us should have a name.
Why would we need a name?
Because we're a team now, and there's four of us, so we should come up with a name for it.
Like, how about two guys, a girl, and the thing that nobody wanted?
Come a long way since the garage.
Gotta say, it's fantastic.
Say that again.
As many of you know, the new Fox film Fantastic Four opened in theaters nationwide last night, and the critic reviews have been less than stellar. Rotten Tomatoes currently has the film sitting at 10%. However, on yesterday's show, John mentioned that he had sources that claimed Fox Studios significantly altered director Josh Trank's movie just prior to and during production of the film.
You know, last night, Josh Trank made the phenomenal mistake of taking to Twitter, and actually, I've got it here. He took to Twitter, and Josh Trank tweeted this. A year ago, I had a fantastic version of this, and it would have received great reviews. You'll probably never see it. That's really tough. This brings up a larger issue within this one specific issue. And, you know, we often talk about studios that interfere with filmmakers, and should they interfere with filmmakers, and how much is it okay to interfere with filmmakers? And I just said, look, I've got a source who was fairly close to the production of this film, who had told me that the movie that Josh Trank and Fox had agreed on making included three really big action set pieces. That was all agreed upon. It was a part of the flow of the movie. And a movie is like a puzzle. You have all the pieces in place. You start messing with pieces, suddenly the whole puzzle can look out of whack. And they had agreed on this vision for a film or whatever. And then days before production began, Fox came in and made him pull three main action sequences out of the film. I was also told that the ending of the film was not even Josh Trank's. At some point, they hijacked the editing bay from him to the point where the edit of the film was done and made without him. Yesterday, both Christian and I spoke with another source. This is a second source that confirmed everything we had heard from my first source, that the studio had come in, taken out big set pieces, taken over the third act of the film, taken over the edit bay of the movie, and essentially put out a film that was not the film that they had originally sat down to make.
Slater's script, unlike the finished film, when the Fantastic Four film is transported to that other dimension, they don't encounter a deserted wasteland, but instead, they find themselves in the middle of an alien graveyard. Shit truly hits the fan when a couple of pages later they discover that the being responsible for the extraterrestrial slaughter is none other than the Devourer of Planets and exotic headwear model, Galactus. The Titan then chases our heroes back to their portal, but not before attacking them with dark matter, which grants the Force some of their fantastic powers, because, you know, that's how dark matter works. One thing the final movie did keep intact from the original script was stranding baddie Victor Von Doom in the middle of the Negative Zone, but rather he becomes a servant to Galactus, who makes him scout the universe for planets that he can eat, apparently making Silver Surfer file for unemployment. Doom eventually escapes the Negative Zone via a portal that scientists in his home country of Latveria were able to cobble together with research stolen from Richard Reed's design. Doom proceeds to channel his maddening rage towards the more productive goal of building a dark matter weapon that can defeat Galactus, who has set his eye on Earth as his next meal. And as much as the Fantastic Four love Doom's whole let's stop the planet-eating monster idea, they just can't get behind his nasty habit of murdering innocent Latverians and ruling his country with an iron fist. This leads to a proper final boss battle between Marvel's First Family and Dr. Doom, while the even greater menace of Galactus is looming in the background. Unfortunately, as great as the script was, big-budget tentpole films aren't made by just sticking to one version of a perfectly fine script. The studio system is simply filled with too many people whose job it is to add their two cents to what they think a movie should look like. The original screenwriter might want to pay homage to the 60s comic books and their B-movie spirit, but the director might want to make a film that's more reminiscent of the sci-fi horror films he grew up watching in the 80s. And then, of course, you have the studio execs who have no idea what any of those words even mean, and ultimately change the movie to what they think will make the most money.
What happened with Fantastic Four, specifically that time frame where they were shooting in Louisiana, which by all accounts was a complete nightmare from the director Josh Trank, losing his mind and almost burning everything down to substance abuse and so forth. We've heard it all, and a lot of it has been confirmed. Now, the latest little wrinkle we can add to this case and a little piece of info is from Kate Mara herself. Now, Kate was Sue Storm, and she recently had an interview with Emmy Magazine where she was asked about the Fantastic Four experience. And without going too much into it, she said that she had, and I quote, a horrible experience. And she doesn't really want to go into everything, but she regrets not standing up for herself, not doing anything about what was happening, what was being said, and how people were being treated on set. Now, for those of you that aren't aware, Trank had a pretty bright career ahead of him. He was hired by Disney. He was going to be the next standalone film before we got Solo, A Star Wars Story. Instead of that, there would have been the Boba Fett movie that he would have directed. They had a teaser trailer ready for Star Wars Celebration. They were committed to it. The script was getting finished. Like, they were knee deep in this, and then everything hit about the reports of what was happening with Fantastic Four. Disney pulled the plug. He was fired. He went on to a bunch of like tirade rants online about everything, and then we've seen ever since then he's fired back and come back at people and apologized and then kind of dove back into that mentality. It's just been it's been an interesting roller coaster ride with this whole thing.
I love the Fantastic Four. I loved the Fantastic Four when I was a kid, because to me, they were like the most realistic characters that I could identify with. They were always fighting with each other, and it wasn't really so much about characters fighting supervillains as much as they were just fighting each other's fighting. Their personalities were fighting against each other, trying to figure out how to do something the right way and together as a team. Imagine if you can travel to another planet in an instant. You know, that would change everything. I mean, you take the, you know, some how many years it would take to get to another planet that has a bunch of stuff that we could need, that we can use to help, you know, heal and fix our own planet. So, but really what it is for them is just the chance of just being able to, out of, you know, they're dedicating their lives to inventing this technology, to just go to this place that they've been dreaming about, specifically Victor.
I feel confident enough at this place that I've heard this from enough places, enough reputable places, to tell you this, that the film that we saw in Fantastic Four was not the film they were supposed to make. It was not the film that Josh Trank made. And this is an instance where I'm totally fine with the studio interfering because it's their movie. But just like the interior decorator thing, once we agree on what it should do, then let the interior decorator do his work once we've agreed on what it's supposed to be. If I said, you know what, I just want that chair over there instead of there, that's fine. Don't go in and say, no, instead of blue, I want brown. Instead of couches, I want beanbag chairs. Instead of this, I want this. Because at the end of the day, it's not even what he designed in the first place. At that point, a studio is going way beyond the line and crossing a lot of creative things. Look, you agreed on a movie. You had a vision together. Now let the filmmaker do his thing once you start the wheels in motion.
Oh my God.
Reed, what happened to me?
I don't know, but I'm gonna figure this out. Ben!
Please, call me, Reed!
Subject one has escaped containment. Subject one has escaped.
Oh, shit! Ben, I'm coming back for you, I promise!
No, Reed, help me! Please don't leave me!
I'm sorry.
Reed, do something, please!
I'd like to bring out director Josh Trank.
In January of 2014, a supposed official synopsis appeared online that made mention of how in this version of the Fantastic Four, the government began using them as weapons. The internet was not happy about this. After all parties had agreed on what movie was going to be made, last minute changes, including the removal of 3 major action set pieces, were imposed on Trank. The reasoning for this? Possibly budgetary, or maybe they were still spooked by negative fan reaction. Regardless, department heads scrambled to try and get this project back on track, whilst at the same time, decisions were still being made by indecisive studio heads. Then the rumors started circulating about the director himself, trashing the New Orleans house he was staying in with his dogs whilst filming, and being indecisive and not communicating to all parties on set. Now, there's enough reports online to indicate that this is, at the very least, partially true. And the thing is, this shouldn't be the manner in which a person conducts themselves when headlining a major motion picture. But I can't help feel that this wouldn't have happened if the studio hadn't made such drastic last-minute changes and then apparently continued to interfere the length of the 72-day shoot.
And it's one of those things where when you're making a film with a giant studio and $120 million is on the table, right. It's much different than when you have a $5 million or a $10 million or even a $15 million, let's even say a $30 million film. You're talking 120 plus PNR advertising. There's a lot of money riding on not just the opening weekend, but worldwide, and how many legs is it going to have per week? So there's a lot of money that people are wanting to get back on something. A lot of people, even those other two Fantastic Four movies made some money, They were critically derided and not looked at fondly. So let's go with it in a different direction. Let's hire this other person who's going to put a different spin on it, put a different perspective on it. Don't take it away from them halfway through the movie. Don't second guess them and play mental mind games with them throughout the entire movie. Don't take the special effects guy that you hired who won an Oscar and replace him with someone else and not tell the director himself. Or the special effects guy who's now quit and left the industry. Have a little bit of respect for the people that you hired to actually do the film. Then you might actually have a good film.
And the thing is, Fox aren't all bad. Studios interfere all the time. I like what they've done with the X-Men franchise. Will Josh Trank bounce back though? Well, there were rumors that he was fired from his Star Wars standalone film due to Kinberg's involvement in the franchise. But I'm not so sure that this is the case. Maybe he genuinely does want to make smaller films, as opposed to feeling bullied by another major studio.
This was a few months after Fantastic Four was released. I pretty much blown up my own career through all kinds of, you know, it's a very complicated story about how it all went down. I mean, a lot of it has been detailed. Various stories are coming out. So to, you know, not take up all of your time on something that's out there, it's, you know, basically my career had ended, or so it felt like. And it was only a few years before that I was in a position in Hollywood, a very rare position where it really felt like the world was at my fingertips. I was making these huge deals. I was working on the biggest possible movies. I was, you know, having meetings with living icons and just the most powerful people in our industry and being involved in just massive events. And suddenly I was just sitting there in eerie silence, reflecting on everything and feeling disappointed in myself. And I was dealing with a bit of insomnia, and when I was able to get any sleep, the sleep that I was having, where I was plagued by these really intense nightmares of all of my memories of everything that I just, the life that I just sort of, you know, walked away from in a lot of ways.